Welcome, I'm Archispan Mahapatra from Noida, and I take this opportunity of having you as our audience for this second part of a two-part series that we had on the recently launched Government of India SOP for containment and management of COVID-19 in peri-urban, rural and tribal areas. On 16th of May, the Government of India came up with these guidelines, and we're trying to have deliberations around it and disseminate it as much as we could. I have my colleague, Dr. Malatesh Undi. Malatesh, to you.
Thank you, Dr. Archis. Hello, everyone. So far in the first episode, we all listened to the lead authors who actually prepared and spoke about SOP on COVID-19 containment and management in peri-urban, rural and tribal areas, which will be helpful for managing the present pandemic as well as for future preparedness.
In this part two, we have opening remarks from Dr. Sunila Garg, who led the entire activity. Madam is also the president of Indian Association of Preventive and Social Medicine. Following opening remarks from Professor Garg, we have opening remarks from Professor Sanjay Zodpe, who is the Vice President of Public Health Foundation of India, Director, Indian Institute of Public Health, the past National President of Indian Association of Preventive and Social Medicine. He is also one of the lead authors for these SOPs. Thereafter, we have detailed PPT-based presentations by some of the co-authors who were part of this entire drafting exercise. So we have Dr. Anuj Mundra and Dr. Arjun Jaksania from MGIMS Wardha and Dr. Priyamadav Behra from AIIMS Bhubaneswar, who would take us through the details of the SOP using the slides. We hope that the entire exercise helps in standardizing our understanding around the guidelines and in taking them further as per our local contexts.
Dear Dr. Zodpe and all my fellow colleagues, warm greetings to all of you. As you are all aware of that, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India released Standard Operating Procedures Manual for COVID-19 Containment Management in Peri-Urban, Rural and Tribal Areas, which has been prepared under the aegis of Niti Aayog, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare and National Health Mission. The document is visionary work of members of IAPSM, Indian Public Health Association, and representatives from different disciplines. So it encompasses a multidisciplinary approach. That is the best part of this document. Since the document has been prepared, equally Ministry of Health and Family Welfare has moved out at an accelerated pace to issue directions to the district collectors. Simultaneously, you know, we are giving directions to all level of people or all the stakeholders who have been involved in preparation of this document. And a toolkit has been prepared, which has been very handy for district collectors. Along with this, a pictorial user-friendly document has also been brought out by Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. The important part of this document is that community is at the center stage. And all the contributors to this document have taken into consideration that community members will play a critical role along with involvement of frontline workers, village leaders, Panchayati Raj institutions, Gram Sabha, and all the other people which are related to implementation of services in the rural area. The innovation of this document lies in form of home treatment, monitoring of symptomatics at home level as well, and their isolation if required. And pulse oximetry and thermometers is going to be provided, you know, for management of the people and monitoring of people at home level as well. And it is going to be supplemented by home kit, which is going to contain, you know, the tablets like paracetamol and vitamins and zinc and all, which will be discussed in detail to threadbare level by some of our important colleagues and who played a critical role, you know, in form of a detailed presentation. The details of the document incorporating three-tier infrastructure. Another which is important is cleaning and disinfection. Management is also, you know, prepared in detail through the, you know, experts which have been contributing to this document. The role of telemedicine and post-COVID management and NGOs has also been amply highlighted. The structured presentation will be very useful for graduates, postgraduates of not only community medicine or public health, but all the disciplines, policy makers, program managers, and implementers at district and community level as well. With this, I would like to thank the entire team who, with the able guidance of Niti Aayog, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India, National Health Mission, prepared this document. Please stay safe, stay healthy, and ensure that no fellow citizen, due to lack of care in any part of the country, succumbs to COVID-19. Thank you very much.
Hi, everyone. Greetings from Indian Association of Preventive and Social Medicine. And I also represent Public Health Foundation of India. I have a great pleasure of informing you that IAPSM played an important and significant role and provided technical assistance in drafting SOPs on COVID-19 containment and management in peri-urban, rural and tribal areas. These guidelines are recently released by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India, in the last week on 16th of May 2021. We are grateful to the Ministry and the Niti Aayog for providing us this opportunity to contribute towards this very important national initiative. This is an important and timely contribution of IAPSM in containment of pandemic. And I would like to appreciate and compliment efforts put in by our team in accomplishing this very critical and important task. Many congratulations to team IAPSM. We all realize and recognize that COVID-19 outbreak in the country is still predominantly is urban phenomena. However, besides urban areas reporting large number of cases, particularly in the second wave that we had seen, there has been a gradual increase now being seen in peri-urban, rural and tribal areas as well. Particularly the later part of the second wave, we have witnessed this phenomena, particularly in the rural areas. And in view of this, there is a need to enable communities, strengthen our both public sector and the private sector engagement, particularly in the context of primary healthcare level infrastructure at all the levels, to intensify our COVID-19 response in peri-urban, rural and tribal areas, while continuing to provide our other essential health services. It is important to ensure that community-based services and primary level healthcare infrastructure, particularly in these areas, is equipped and oriented to manage the COVID-19 cases. Primary healthcare facilities and health facilities in the private sector in these areas play a quite important and significant role in delivering health services to the population. And this document, and I would say that these SOPs, outlines the containment and clinical management practices to be put in place in these areas with respect to the COVID-19 containment and management. Mostly, if you look at the scope of this document, where we focused into includes the surveillance, screening and isolation and referral. It also emphasizes on home and community-based isolation, then monitoring of active cases in home isolation, planning for health infrastructure and for managing, particularly at the rural level, post-COVID management, community mobilization and behavior change communication. It also throws light on mental health support at the community level, then adequate provision of support services, and also deals with intersectoral coordination. Then undertaking of public health functions by the primary health center and community health centers in COVID containment operations. And of course, preparedness for rapid coverage with COVID vaccination remains very important area which this particular SOP deals with. The non-COVID essential healthcare delivery services are importantly highlighted. Establishment of COVID specific cell centers at the district level and ensuring utilization of telehealth facilities. And also also highlights the tribal COVID care and response strategies for the tribal areas. I am confident that these guidelines would help us to plan and prepare in dealing with expanding pandemic, particularly in peri-urban, rural and tribal areas. These guidelines are currently being widely disseminated and they are in circulation and also are shared with the states and district administrations. We have also prepared the video presentation on these guidelines. And I request all our departments of community medicine in medical colleges and our IAPSM members who are particularly working in these departments of community medicine to engage with local district administration in disseminating these guidelines and also participate in related training activities. I see this as a very timely opportunity for our association to contribute quite significantly and effectively at the ground level towards containment of this pandemic and exhibit our national commitment in advancing public health agenda in the country. Academic and research institutions like Public Health Foundation of India, we have Indian Institutes of Public Health established in Delhi, Gandhinagar, Shillong, Bhubaneswar, Hyderabad, and we also have a center in Bangalore. We would like to leverage the presence of these institutions across the country also to engage them in dissemination of these activities and also to explore the possibilities of engaging with the state governments where we can help the state governments in facilitating and implementing these guidelines, particularly in the selected districts or across the states. Similar institutions like which we have IHMR group of institutions, we have several schools of public health which are affiliated to various universities in India. We have good non-governmental organizations working in different parts of the country. Development partners can also play an important role in dissemination of these guidelines and training at the ground level. We need to recognize that for dissemination of these guidelines and ensuring that these guidelines are implemented in at the district level and within the districts, it is important for all of us to join hands and see that how do we advance this agenda. Because the next wave, it might come, will have much more significant presence in the rural areas, peri-urban areas, and tribal areas. And therefore, now it is timely that we prepare ourselves and gear ourselves so that we respond to this pandemic in a more prepared way. And therefore, I would request support and cooperation from all our public health professionals and members of our associations to come forward in facilitating implementation of these guidelines in the districts. I wish you all the best in taking this initiative forward, and thank you so much for this gracious opportunity. Thank you.
Welcome back, everybody. And now we have already discussed the background and scope of this document for the standard operating procedures in peri-urban, rural, and tribal areas in a previous video. So in this video, we'll start with the basic descriptions of the procedures under the document. So we'll start with surveillance, screening, isolation, and referral for COVID-19. So what the document proposes is an active surveillance for influenza-like illness or severe acute respiratory illnesses periodically by ASHA workers with the help of VHNSCs. And this active surveillance should be taken up in each and every village. And once we identify suspects through these surveillance, there should be facilities for triaging of symptomatic patients in teleconsultation with the community health officer of the health and wellness center. And then identified suspected COVID cases and high-risk contacts of these patients should be quarantined and should be linked for testing to appropriate health facility. And for the testing, there should be a provision of rapid antigen test kits at public health facilities, such as the sub-centers, health and wellness centers, and primary health centers. And they may also be linked for transport of samples for RT-PCR testing. And there should be contact tracing as per IDSP guidelines for as far as feasible and if possible for all the patients of COVID-19. Then coming to home and community-based isolation. So one thing that we all have learned in the past 1 year is that nearly 80 to 85% of COVID-19 cases are either asymptomatic or mild symptomatic. And such cases may not need hospitalization and they may be easily managed at home or in the COVID care center, COVID care isolation facilities in accordance with the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare guidelines. But care should be taken that monitoring of these active cases should be done adequately when they are in home isolation or the community-based isolation. So each village should have adequate number of pulse oximeters and thermometers for monitoring of these cases. And these pulse oximeter and thermometers, they can be provided on loan basis to families who have a confirmed case of COVID. And later when the patient recovers of COVID, this may be given to some other family where there is an active case of COVID. And care should be taken that if the same pulse oximeter or thermometer is being used by more than one person, care should be taken to sanitize it with a piece of cotton or cloth soaked in alcohol-based sanitizer so that the infection does not transmit. Then follow-up of these patients under isolation or quarantine should be done through household visits by either a frontline worker or the volunteer base that has been identified by the village or any teacher, and only after duly following the required infection prevention and control practices. Such patients who are in home isolation should also be provided with a home isolation kit, which should have all the required medicines. And it should also have a detailed pamphlet which indicates what precautions are to be taken while in home isolation, what medication are to be taken, what doses are to be taken. There should be a monitoring pro forma for the patients to monitor and note down their symptoms and signs. Contact details of any person who should be contacted in case of an emergency or worsening of symptoms, that should also be there in the pamphlet, and the discharge criteria should also be mentioned. And all these patients should be informed that they need to seek immediate mental medical attention in case they have any difficulty in breathing, in case there is a dip in the oxygen saturation to less than 94% on room air, in case they have persistent pain or pressure in the chest, in case they face mental confusion or inability to arouse. All such cases which need medical attention should be referred to a facility, preferably with an oxygen bed if the saturation falls low, to a DCHC or DCH, depending on whatever is the oxygen saturation level. So any patient who is under home isolation will stand discharged at the end of isolation, which will be after 10 days of having passed from the onset of symptoms, or in case of asymptomatic patients, from the date of sampling. And they should also have a period of 3 days where they did not have any fever. And one important thing which we need to highlight here is that there is no need of retesting after the home isolation period is over. So we do not need to retest with RT-PCR. So the next point in the guideline will be planning for health infrastructure for managing COVID at rural level. So as we all know that there was already a three-tier structure which was devised for management of COVID-19 cases in the previous wave also. So these were the COVID care center, which was designated for mild or asymptomatic cases, which is defined as only upper respiratory tract symptoms, no breathlessness, and with a SpO2 of more than 94% on room air. The second one is the dedicated COVID health center, that is the DCHC, which is designated to design to manage the moderate cases, that is breathless patients with breathlessness, a respiratory rate of more than 24 per minute, SpO2 between 90 to 94% on room air. And the third is the dedicated COVID hospital, which is to manage the severe cases of COVID. So these health infrastructure planned for peri-urban, rural and tribal areas shall be aligned to the above mentioned three-tier structure. So infrastructure in the, first we talk about the COVID care structure. So coming to the infrastructure here, first thing, it should be there to manage the asymptomatic cases with comorbidities or mild cases. Importantly, where home isolation is not possible, these should be, these may be makeshift or temporary facilities and should function under the supervision of the nearest PHC or CHC. Facilities or spaces in the schools, community halls, marriage halls, panchayat buildings, some tented facilities in the panchayat land or school ground. So such facilities may be utilized for making these makeshift or temporary facilities to be utilized as the COVID care center in the rural areas. And when we plan for these, we may plan for at least 30 bedded capacity of these COVID care structures with adequate spacing between the beds, proper ventilation, and other basic requirements like facilities of electricity, drinking water, So these kind of basic requirements should also be there in these COVID care centers. And there may be separate areas, entry and exits for suspected and confirmed cases if feasible. And these COVID care centers, they should be linked, they should be mapped and linked with the nearby DCHCs and DCH for referral purposes in case the condition of a patient deteriorates. These COVID care centers should also have a basic life support ambulance, which should be equipped with oxygen support. And such ambulances, they should be networked amongst CCCs for ensuring safe referral of patients if the symptoms worsen, that is, if the saturation drops or if there is any other worsening of symptom. And for such purpose, in such cases, there should also be facility of oxygen concentrator or cylinder in these COVID care centers. Coming to the human resources for these COVID care centers, the nodal officer may be the CHO or the MPW or the ANM with support from ASHA worker or the Anganwadi workers. The technical guidance may be from the medical officer of the nearby PHC or the community health officer of the nearby health and wellness center. The responsibility for maintenance of these COVID care centers should lie with Gram Panchayat, VHNSC or the Mahila Arogya Samiti in urban areas, in urban or peri-urban areas basically. If deemed needful by the Gram Panchayat, they may also hire additional staff for sanitation and maybe maintenance if needed. And then there may be other human resources, the manpower which may be required for running these COVID care centers. We may have certain people like Ayush doctors, there may be final year Ayush students, final year BSc nursing students, then there may be some volunteers from the villages or the nearby areas, the Mahila Arogya Samiti in urban areas. So these we may utilize people from these cadres to help us in running these COVID care centers. Coming to the clinical management, basically if we see these cases would be either mild or mild symptomatic or asymptomatic. So basically we would need symptomatic management for fever, running nose and cough as per the symptoms. We may also promote gargles, the saline gargles or steam inhalation for the patients as per the need and as per the technical guidance. Ivermectin may be considered for use among the patients. And if the symptoms do not improve, so we can consider use of drugs like naproxen, inhalational or oral steroids, but care should be taken and such systems should be devised that these drugs are used only in consultation with the nearest medical officer of the PHC. In case the saturation goes down to less than 94% or the patient becomes breathless, such patients should be put on oxygen immediately and referral should be arranged. And for this purpose only, we have already talked about the availability of oxygen cylinders or concentrators in these COVID care centers. And discharge of the patient should be done as per the existing guidelines from the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, or if there are any guidelines from the state level. Coming to the dedicated COVID health center, these should be catered to all the clinically assigned moderate cases. Again, the definition we have covered earlier. Facilities like primary health center, community health center, sub-district or sub-divisional hospital, private facilities in these areas, they can be repurposed for use as DCHC. And again, when we make these DCHC, we should plan for at least a 30-bedded facility in these centers. And then again, these centers should be prepared to increase the beds as per the trajectory of the cases. As and when the cases start rising, the facilities should start increasing the number of beds which have been dedicated for these DCHCs. And if the beds or space is an issue, some temporary arrangements may be made within the facility, or if there is some facility available adjacent to these facilities. Non-COVID services should be continued, care should be taken that because of COVID-related activities, the non-COVID services are not affected, and these may be continued in a separate dedicated area within the facility. And such facilities, again, as in COVID care center, these DCHCs should also admit both the confirmed and suspected cases which have been assigned as clinically moderate cases, and care should be taken that the suspected and confirmed cases should not mix. So we may have a separate dedicated room for the suspected cases. And again, these DCHCs should have assured oxygen supply and ambulance availability in these facilities. So coming to the dedicated COVID hospital, the infrastructure part, so district hospitals, any tertiary care hospitals in the district, any identified private hospitals, or a block of these hospitals. So these can be repurposed to function as the dedicated COVID hospital in the district. And if there is any sub-district or block level hospital which fulfills the requirement of for functioning as dedicated COVID hospital, they may also be designated as the dedicated COVID hospital. These dedicated COVID hospitals should be linked with a few identified COVID care centers and the dedicated COVID health centers in their catchment areas. And again, for dedicated COVID hospitals also, the upgradation of health facilities should be based on the case trajectory. As and when the cases start increasing, we start to increase the bed capacity in these dedicated COVID hospitals. And there should be a dedicated basic life support ambulance with oxygen support on 24/7 basis in each of these dedicated COVID hospitals. Coming to clinical management at the designated COVID health centers and designated COVID hospitals, one thing which should be encouraged is awake proning, because most of these patients would be having low oxygen saturation. So awake proning is to be encouraged in all the patients admitted in these facilities. And then when we talk about management of the patients, the clinical management, there are already, we have the existing guidelines from the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare for adult as well as pediatric cases. We've also given the link in the slides, which can be referred. In facilities where we do not have specialist services, for example, in primary health centers and in some of the community health centers, we may also not have specialists. So in those places also, drugs like ivermectin, hydroxychloroquine, inhalational or injectable steroids, they may be considered by the treating doctor depending on the condition of the patient. Now, this was about the management of COVID cases. Talking about post-COVID management, again, it is equally important that recovered patients should be followed up for post-COVID complications. And on discharge, these patients should be counseled for whatever complications they may have, whatever things they may have to do to avoid those complications. So they need to be counseled for management at home. They should be counseled about the danger signs, the precautions that they should take, and the various respiratory exercises that they should undertake at in their homes. Now, patients with comorbidities, they should also be followed up. The comorbidities should be assessed, and treatment for the comorbid condition should be continued or modified as needed on a case-to-case basis. Again, for post-COVID management, telemedicine services may also be utilized so that these patients do not have to come visit the hospitals repeatedly. And again, we also have a protocol by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare for post-COVID management, and the link is given in the slides. So the next point in the SOP is about community mobilization and behavior change communication. So here, as you can see, the document talks about a multi-pronged strategy for community mobilization, which envisages the engagement of Panchayati Raj institutions, BHNSCs, women's self-help groups, teachers, youth groups, and other volunteer base that we can get in the program. The primary responsibility for the community mobilization should lie with the Gram Panchayat or VHNSC at village level and the block development officer at the block level. Now, this block development officer should also be able to identify a mentor for a cluster of villages. Say 4 or 5 villages would be mentored by a person, and that person is to be identified by the block development officer. Again, in this community mobilization, what the villages also need to do is the resource mapping, and they also need to see the village level preparedness. To assess the village level preparedness, the document also has a village preparedness checklist in the annexures, which talks in great detail about what measures need to be taken to assess the preparedness of the villages. So a successful campaign against COVID-19 will also need a successful decentralized model of care. So the components of these of this decentralized model would be the primary one would be to bring the gram panchayats at the forefront and empower them with financial allocation and administrative empowerment. The next important point would be to protect the high risk and vulnerable groups, and also to limit the spread of virus by advance payment of pension benefits to older to the beneficiaries under the national and state pension scheme, so that they have adequate monetary resources also with them, and so that they do not have to come out of the house repeated times. The next point, important point, would be opening up of temporary medical centers and COVID care centers at gram panchayat level, which again can be managed at the local level with community participation. And then there should be strengthening of the community based management, and this can be done by engaging our frontline workers like the Anganwadi workers, ANMs, ASHAs, and they should be adequately supported by other village level functionaries or the gram panchayat members. So they will play a crucial role in strengthening the community based management of COVID-19 patients.
So the next section of the document talks about the mental health support at community level. So as we know from the different part of the country, it is frequently reported that there is a rise of the mental health problems like risk of getting depression, suicidal tendency, and various anxiety issues. There is a fear and stigma associated with disease as well as the response to the disease like lockdown, and it can cause to the rise of such mental health issues. So psychological support to the community to help them to remain mentally sound during this time of pandemic would be an important element for the COVID response. Next section of the document talks about adequate provision of support services and intersectoral coordination at community level. It will be very important to ensure that basic needs of all the families, including migrants, are fulfilled. There is a need of provision of alternative employment opportunities through Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act. The management of dead bodies and funeral should be done in accordance with the guidelines from Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, and link of the guideline is attached in the document. The next section is on the undertaking of public health functions by PSC and CDC in COVID containment operations. So if it is there is a need of making a containment areas, then there should be an active involvement of primary health center and community health center lying nearby to that containment or buffer zone. And the medical officer of such facilities should be discharged the responsibility of nodal officer for that COVID-19 surveillance and containment area. The nodal officer of this containment area would be responsible for familiarization with the containment plan, surveillance manuals, training of field staff and task delegation, logistic arrangement to that buffer zone or containment areas, and supportive supervision. He would be responsible for the decision making for the home isolation, liaison with other units and stakeholders, and to identify, test, isolate, treat, and refer suspected cases as per ICMR guidelines, and to collect various information, compile, and disseminate data from the field staff to the higher authorities. To do this task, various guidelines and advisories are already published from the government, and these are already cited in the document. The next section talk about preparedness for rapid coverage with COVID vaccination. As we know, that high vaccination coverage will be pivotal for the future, preventing future waves. And to ensure high vaccination coverage in rural areas, with help of frontline workers, along with community leaders, the community mobilization efforts should be done. Locally adopted IEC materials should be developed to facilitate community mobilization and to address vaccine hesitancy. The next section talks about non-COVID essential healthcare delivery services. So while we are discharging the COVID-19 related services, it is very important to ensure that there should be a continuity of non-COVID essential health services like RMNCHA+A services, non-communicable diseases, and other communicable diseases services and medical emergencies. We can adopt various strategy and telemedicine here can be used for discharging various health services for non-COVID health problems. Next section talks about establishment of COVID-specific call centers at district level and utilization of telehealth facilities. It is advisable to have district-level information help desk, which can provide information to the community on various health facilities available, availability of oxygen and non-oxygen beds, availability of various transportation modalities, availability related to vaccines and other guidelines related to home isolation and COVID-19 treatment. Here, eSanjeevani OPD and other telemedicine initiatives should for the COVID and non-COVID essential services.
As you know, this document tells about the peri-urban, rural and tribal COVID care activities. The tribal area or hard to reach area has some specific focus that has to be done, because these are difficult areas and has poor access to health care. In order to strengthen COVID-19 care in these areas, we need to involve Gram Sabha so that the community-based management can be improved. And every stage of planning as executing COVID care activities, Gram Sabha need to be taken into confidence. Then another important or key aspect in the tribal area, because government has a existence of health system in forms of PHC, CHC along with mobile medical unit. The mobile medical units actually reach the hard to reach areas, and this mobile medical unit can be integrated with COVID care in hard to reach areas or tribal areas. And these mobile medical unit can perform various activities. This may be, they can may be involved to generate awareness for COVID appropriate behavior. They may be involved in testing of COVID, like they can perform rapid antigen test, they can sample to conduct RT-PCR, they can treat mild COVID disease, they can be useful for referral in case those who are serious or moderate COVID cases. Telemedicine may be very important, particularly to breach the geographical inaccessibility. However, where the internet connectivity is not good, then we'll to look for alternatives. There are a lot of NGOs in working in these remote areas. They have their existence for a long time. They may be very useful for providing COVID care because of their community rapport and local existence.
Let's look at the annexes which are there in our document. We have total 4 annexes. So the first annexes and the sub annexes are for the COVID care center. And it is showing the required equipments and consumables for the COVID care center. So Annexer 1A talk about the various equipment like BP machines, SpO2 machines, their quantity and the various list of the equipment which may be required at COVID care center. Annexer 1B talks about the various consumables item like N95 mask, face shield for the COVID care center with requirements. And Annexer 1C talk about the various drugs and testing kits which may be required at COVID care center with desired quantity. Annexer 2 talk about the subjective scheme of patient movement at PHC-CHC. It is a diagram which is showing that how patient flow can be managed to prevent cross-infection between patients who are coming at PHC and CHC for COVID and non-COVID care. Annexer 3 and subsections talk about various requirement at dedicated COVID health center. So Annexer 3A talk about various equipments and their quantity. Annexer 3B talk about the list of consumables and their desired quantity. And Annexer 3C talk about required drugs, testing kits with their quantity at dedicated COVID health center. Annexer 4 is checklist for community preparedness for COVID-19 response. It is a detailed checklist which can be used as an action tool. It is supposed to be used by Gram Panchayat member or VHNSC member to assess the preparedness at Gram Panchayat level, which can help them to take timely action for prevention of COVID-19. It is supposed to be filled fortnightly, and nodal person can be identified Gram Panchayat level to fill this checklist. Gram Panchayat secretary is supposed to supervise this process, and he is supposed to share the information with extension officer at block development office. Now the block development officer will take appropriate action and share the information at Jilla Parishad or district panchayat office at the district collector.
Hope you found the presentations of the guidelines useful
We hope that the detailed presentations help in easy understanding and dissemination of these guidelines. The videos and the PPTs can be adapted to local language. We shall leave the PPT slides and a link to the background plenary, that is a part one of this series, and also to the SOPs in the description of this video.
And it may help you to disseminate for a wider population. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you.